Well, good afternoon once again, and invited guests, participants, welcome back, and I hope you all enjoyed your meal. Juma Mubarak to all of you. We are a little bit behind schedule, however, I'd like to read a little of Professor Jiri, who is conducting this workshop today. Professor Jiri Jaromír Klemeš is a professor and head of Sustainable Process Integration Laboratory, SPIL, NETME Center, Faculty of Mechanical Engineering, Brno University of Technology, BUT, Brno, Czech Republic, and he is Emeritus Professor at Center for Process Systems Engineering and Sustainability. Pasmani Peter Catholic University, Budapest, Hungary, previously the Project Director, Senior Project Officer, and Honorary Leader at the Department of Process Integration at UMIST, the University of Manchester, and University of Edinburgh. He is the founder and a long-term head of the Center for Process Integration and Intensification, CP12, University of Pannonia, Veszprém, Hungary, awarded by EC with Marie Curie's Chair of Excellence. He has a track record of managing and coordinating 91 major EC, NATO, and UK know-how projects. Research funding attracted over 21 million euro, and he is the co-editor-in-chief of Journal of Cleaner Production. He authored nearly 400 papers, a number of books published by Elsevier, McGraw-Hill, Woodhead, Ashgate Publishing, Cambridge, Springer, Wiley, Taylor and Francis, and he is the chairperson of CAPE Working Party of EFCE, a member of WP on Process Intensification, and of the EFCE Sustainability Platform. Several times distinguished visiting professor for University Technology Malaysia, Jia'an Jiaotong University, South China University of Technology, Guangzhou, Tianjin University in China, University of Maribor, Slovenia University, Technology Petronas, Malaysia, the Brno University of Technology, and the Russian Mendeleev University of Chemical Technology, Moscow. Dr. Honoris Causa of Karvik National University, Karvik Polytechnic Institute in Ukraine, the University of Maribor in Slovenia, University Polytechnica, Bucharest, Romania, Honorary Doctor of Engineering, University Technology Malaysia, Honorary Member of Czech Society of Chemical Engineering, European Federation of Chemical Engineering, Lifetime Achiever Award, and Pro University Panonica Gold Medal. It keeps going on and on and on. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to stop here and invite Professor Jiri Jaromír. Welcome on stage, please. And please, for those of us who would want to know more about Professor Jiri, kindly ask Uncle Google. Professor Jiri Jaromír will be presenting here on the topic, how to publish in a high impact factor journal. He will also be here with us tomorrow, where he will be presenting a keynote, and tomorrow morning, and the rest of tomorrow. So it's good to have you again, and welcome, Professor Jiri. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. You know, I do apologize, because when you reach certain age, you don't need to make lecture. It's enough if somebody reads your CV, and it's enough. I would like to say, the first, I'm very happy that we've got a full house, and it seems that some people even have to stand up, so I hope we can find some more chairs. We've got good lunch, which is a little bit challenging for the lecturer, because after good lunch, you know, we naturally fall asleep, which happened to me before the lecture, but fortunately, Dr. Alec woke me up. And I would like to share with you a little bit of my experience, which I did more than 50 years, because I published my first paper in 1970, when probably most of you were not still born. And it was a very, very different world. It was no internet. To publish 2-3 papers a year, it was an achievement. And it depended very much on the efficiency of the post office, because all the reviews, everything was done by snail post. Anyway, to tell you something about my children and grandchildren, one of the charts is Journal of Cleaner Production. And as it happens with children, they are growing. And this chart is growing a little bit too much. Elsevier call it mega journal, because this year we already got more than 12,000 entries. 12,000. Can you imagine? 1,000 every month. From the morning, I've got another 16 papers that I just checked during the lunch break. So, for this reason, we've got 3 co-editors in chief, and we more or less divided the world, not like the British Empire, divide and rule. We did it to collaborate, and I am mainly responsible for Europe and Middle East, but not only, because it's also my specialties. And Cecilia is a Brazilian lady doing mainly America, and Yuta Wang from Fudan, Shanghai, is doing China, Asia, but I'm doing a lot of Malaysia as well. Now, because we would like to talk about publishing in good journals, and good journal, well, impact factor is something what administrators love. You know, if you are making application for a job, you are coming to human resources and they are asking, what is your H index? Well, higher H index doesn't mean necessarily that the researcher is better. I've got my personal experience, my close friend, and the pioneer of process integration has got H index about 20. And all of his 20 papers got about 5-6 plus 100 citations. So you can do it like this, and you can do it like it is now, and I personally would like it, but what we should do if you would like to be senior lecturer, if you like to be the professor, if you would like to be whatever, they are asking you for H index. And now about the journal's metrics. If you look for a good journal, one issue is Google Scholar. And Google Scholar, each of those metrics got advantages and disadvantages, pros and cons. Google Scholar is beautiful in one thing. It catches everything, and very fast. If somebody publishes something yesterday, it's already in today. And it means it's very flexible, but you have to be careful, because it catches even when you write an article to the journal. It is also there. So you have to be responsible and keep your profile clean. Even more complicated this, I'm quite lucky because my surname is rather unique. I've got just two relatives who already retired or passed away, and nobody with the same name. But if your name is Wang, Li, Liu, Johansson, Smith, Brown, this is really very difficult. Another of my good colleagues, Professor Robin Smith from Manchester, wanted it recently because we nominated him for a big British prize. And he and his PhDs took about 3 weeks to clean Robin Smith's profile from all other Robin Smiths, which are all over the world. So this is issue with publications. But there are some people who are also misusing it. They are writing some funny articles, and Google Scholar is capturing it and artificially increasing H index. So, pros and cons. I'm saying one thing, and you should make it as well. As long as your citations are growing, it's okay. If they stop to grow, well, it's the time either to retire or to change the job if you are young, because it seems that something is wrong with your research. It's not catching more attention. But believe me, if you come to those numbers close to 2000, it's not so easy. If you are in numbers 10, 20, 30, the grow is okay. Well, another quite credible metrics for a database for citation is Scopus. I think everybody knows Scopus here. It's Elsevier, and originally it was limited only to Elsevier publications. But nowadays Elsevier would like to become the worldwide and is extending it for nearly everything. What are the problems? Problems are it's not as fast as Google Scholar, and it suffers from one issue. There are some journals which are now, unfortunately, Clima Production is one of them. They are already publishing papers in 2019. So you've got some shifts from year to year, and you can get those ups and downs, because journal published something a little bit later or early. Now, H-index. You can notice that H-index, you will have obviously different in Google Scholar, different in Scopus, different in Web of Science. Why it is? Well, one issue is the speed, because Google Scholar is capturing everything. Web of Science used to be notoriously late. It changed recently with the new owner. New owner of Web of Science is no longer Thomson Reuters, but Clarivate Analytics, who are starting to move much more swiftly. So don't be worried if your H index is on those other matrices longer. If everything is okay, it will grow, but after some time. Problem is if you need to be promoted within 2 months, and Web of Science have been traditionally 6-8 months late. So it might cause some problems. And now we are coming to H-index. I will talk about it a little bit more. I think everybody knows it. H-index is the number. If your citation in sequence, when it's equal with number, the sequential number is equal with the number of citations. So it means if your 10th most published, most cited publication has got 10 citations, you've got H-index 10. But I'll show you the graphs later. Now we are coming to Web of Science. As I said, Web of Science is much, much slower still. And it might take 6, 8, sometimes 10 months before your publication appears there. And they made some embarrassing mistakes. I've got one personal experience when I was editor of proceedings from the conference, which were in the Web of Science, and they made me author of 550 proceedings, which is totally incorrect and destroys everything. So I have to ask them and one by one delete it from the profile. Somebody would be probably happy, but it's not good. In Web of Science, you've got some categories, and one category is highly cited papers and highly cited authors. And what it means, they are making it by 1% of top cited papers over 1 year, over 2 years, and finally forever. And if you manage to get to this category, it's obviously something fine with your research, because people are very much interested in your research. And generally it's not too easy, but if you, and we will talk about it, if you pick up the right hot topic, you can get a chance. And those are the papers which I managed to get to these categories. And you can see one interesting issue. All those papers are multidisciplinary. It happened when I was PhD student, they were specialized journals, because I am originally a mechanical and chemical engineer, like Chemical Engineering Science, ICHE, American Institution of Chemical Engineering. And those journals used to have very high impact factor, you know, 12, 14, but not anymore. If you are doing optimization of, say, some special reactor, it can be very fine research, but there are not too many people who are interested. It might be 20, 30 people, and it's very difficult to get a high number of citations. If you are doing something hot and multidisciplinary, you've got much better chance. And this is the message which I'm telling to my PhD students. You have to decide what you would like to do. Either focused specialist, which is fine and we need them, but probably your citations will not be very high. Or you to do something that is the hot topic, and what are now the hot topics, I will show you tomorrow. This is circular economy, is a very hot topic, emissions, greenhouse gases, fog, smoke, and other things which are important for many, many people. Another database which is quite recent, and I very much suggest you to get profile. Who has got a profile in Publots? Please raise the hand. No? Okay. Good, good. Please do it. It's very easy to make the profile. It's part of Web of the Science. It's also run by Clarivate Analytics. And I'm talking about Mendeley. Mendeley is similar stuff run by Elsevier. Elsevier would promote this, but personally, Publons is what is related to the Web of Science, and by my humble understanding, it's better. Even when I am editor for Elsevier, I am talking with them, they would like, they are pushing Mendeley, but Publon is much, much more handy, and it's being nicely developed. And you should get to the profile, and it actually is keeping a record about your reviews, if you are editor, if what you edited, and also about your publications. And there are a couple of interesting issues. Number of reviews, merit is for reviews and for excellent reviews, because publishers got also evaluation of reviews. We will talk later about reviews. About something what is in the bottom right corner, review to publication ratio. It is called R index, reviewer index. And it's becoming more and more popular. Why? Because if I need to publish, for one of my publications, I need minimum 3 reviews. So, if I should be fair to the scientific community, for 100 papers, I need to make 300 reviews. If not, I am a parasite. And many people are not actually recognizing me. And are writing me, you know, why my paper hasn't been processed, why I should wait for the review 4 months. Well, I'm doing one thing. I'm immediately inviting this person to show that reviewing is a serious job and it takes time. So now top universities, when you are asking for a job or promotion, they are not asking you only for H index, but also for this R index. And I'm quite happy to have 8.5, but you should get minimum 1. It means for each of your publication to make 3 reviews. If not, it's not very good. And Publons got also something which is called highly cited reviewer. And those are again a reviewer, author, highly cited author. And those are again authors which are 1% of the whole community. You have to beat 99% of others by citation to get this kind of, oh, this is not medal, it's the cup. And there are not so many, say in my country, which is not big, we've got a little bit more than 10 million, but we've got 12 highly cited authors. Hungary, which is about the same size, have got 3. The most of them are naturally in the US and now in China, but it would be interesting, you can go to Publons and find how many highly cited authors are in your country. And if you would like to beat this, you must have the profile in Publons. And as I said, it's very easy. You just go to www.publons.com and it guides you to put your data and now how you can get those reviews in. There are journals which are collaborating with Publons and they do it automatically for you. When you make the review, it appears here. And they are all, with exception of Elsevier. Because Elsevier has got Mendeley, and in that case you need to do it manually. But it's not a problem. When you are receiving as a reviewer, thank you for the review, you just forward it to reviews at publons.com and they will put it there. So this is one, and I consider very important message from the workshop, make your Publons profile. And you can also see the ranking of the universities, how your university is standing in the world by number of reviewers and by number of authors and by citations. Everything is there. You can get this those statistics in how many editorial boards you are. You can get also for how many journals you serve as a reviewer. I'm quite happy to have it quite high because it means that many journals are actually recognizing you. And how to get it, person should be known a little bit. But everybody started from one, and I'm teaching my PhDs to do all this, and within 1 or 2 years of PhD, they are doing pretty well. And, this is the introduction, and now something where I am coming from. And I don't know if you've been in Europe. This is Europe, where here is Germany, this is UK, and we are something which is called Central Europe. And my present home city, Brno, is in the very center, and it's beside universities famous for ice hockey team, which is probably not telling you too much, but it's a game which is very popular in the US, Canada, Europe, and now it's coming even to Asia. You know, Japan, China, they are starting to play it. It's a very nice game, and the Brno team, they are the champions. This is Brno, a city about 500,000 people, but beside having 11 universities, it's in the quality of life among top 50 people. 50 cities in the world, and this helps me to attract PhD students, because they are coming and saying, oh, I like it, you know, I was fed up of Manchester, and I was fed up of Beijing or KL and so on. So, what happened? I spent a quarter of century at UMist, University of Manchester Institute of Science and Technology, which used to be always one of the top 10 universities in the world, which is very fine, because when I was visiting professor at UTM, they've got in chemical engineering one floor where there are offices of professors, and when I visited them one by one, in most cases they've got a photograph of graduation from UMist. UTM has been very, very close to UMist, and the present DDC, Professor Zain, used to be my student, and a couple of others. So it was nice, everything was fine, but at the year 2004 happened something very unpleasant. It was merged with the University of Manchester, and most of us decided to leave, because it was the merge like if you merge Fiat and Ferrari. You know, Fiat is mass production cars, but not very exciting. Ferrari is something. But Fiat was clever enough to keep the brand Ferrari, not the Victoria University of Manchester. So we left. And after some spell in Hungary, because I got the Marie Curie Chair of Excellence grant, which is quite good. By the way, for you, if you are from Asia, those Marie Curie grants are quite beneficial. You can get also incoming grants from your country to come for 2-3 years to Europe. And the secret is it's well paid. The bad news is, because it's well paid, the competition is very tough. But for the development of the career, it's not bad. And the European Union is making also opposite grants for visiting countries outside. And it's for different levels. And I've got it for the top level, the Chair of Excellence. And, one of the conditions was to move from Britain to another country and set up a new group, which I did in Hungary. But after 8 years, I decided it's time to return home. And I got another project, which is called SPIL. It's 5 million euros for 5 years to set up a new group. And this is my present group. As you can see, it's a number of foreigners. Tim is from New Zealand, Mohammed is Iranian. Those are Chinese, but two are Malaysian Chinese, and from UTM and from Nottingham, and two Chinese. We will have soon some other. And we've got a lot of collaborators. What is interesting of those collaborators, many of them graduated from UBIS. So it's a little bit like a group of alumni. And this is my another suggestion for you. If you graduate from good university, try to keep the connection with your alumni, because it helps you in the career and helps you very much. Those are universities we are collaborating. Some of them are quite famous, some of them are huge. Fudan is one of top of Chinese. Of course, Manchester is still okay. But we've got Philippines, we've got UPM, and some others. This is what our group is doing. Each of person has got some topics. And now it's enough of the introduction, and we can start with the workshop. Writing a paper. This is a crucial question. Why I should write a research paper? Well, here you've got some answers. Because usually PhD requires 2, 3, 4. As I remember, UPM had got it by sum of impact factor. But it's more or less a must for getting PhD. But it's the target. But I should have a piece of reasonable work which has got, which is based on my research results. It's relevant, makes the sense, fits the context, and this is a problem, because by hunting high impact factors, authors are now like bees smelling honey. You know, when impact factor goes up, you've got a huge impact of authors, but the papers doesn't fit the context, and this is a real problem. So you should be reasonable, and not the last issue, but the crucial issue is it must be novel. The first thing which I am asking as a reviewer, what is the novelty? And novelty in your paper should be very explicitly highlighted, because if it's nothing novel, it's a problem. Why to publish? In that case, you can go to newspaper or journals or magazines, but archive journal requires novelty. And of course, it should be for some researchers. Now, where to get the guidelines? Generally, you've got a couple of websites. Most good English-speaking universities got some websites which are telling you how to organize the paper, how to write the paper. Why I'm saying English universities or English-speaking universities, if we like it or not, the language of technology at the moment is English. I remember my late father, he was a lawyer, and when they met, they were chatting in Latin. It was for medical profession or for lawyer, you know, 50 years ago it was Latin. Nowadays it's English. Maybe within 50 years it might be Chinese or whatever, but at the moment, if we like it or not, we must use English. And it's a little bit tricky where to get good English. Now happened something very interesting in Britain. Our department at the University of Manchester, I'm still saying our because I still got the office and I am visiting staff. You know, when I joined, there were 3 very distinguished English professors. Nowadays, there are 3 professors. One is Turkish, one is from Bosnia-Herzegovina, and one is Romania. And the students, it's no single native English student. and it becomes a big, big problem. I, over all those 25 years, I've got one native English PhD, even when we've got a grant, you know, fully funded. English students are not interested in PhD. They made some funny optimization of lifetime earnings, and they calculated if they do BSc, go to the industry and earn money, or they study MSc, PhD, and earn money, that when they finish the career, they are actually better off without PhD. Well, the choice is theirs. You know, I originally was after graduation in the industry as well, and after moved to academia. Some countries got very good mechanism for it. Germany has got a mechanism when somebody from the industry is more than 40 years old and is very good in the research, can become the professor, and from state money, he's paid the same money as he would do in the industry, which is usually much more. And it worked quite well. Unfortunately, there are not too many countries like this. And so now, where to get good English? I've got a lot of papers from English American universities where English is actually not good at all. Malaysia is Pakistan as well. Those are former colonies, so those are quite lucky countries. Usually the language is not bad. It has got some versions, because if you open, for example, the word, you can see that you've got about 15 different variations of English. It's US, UK, Malaysian, Indian, and whatever. And I can when I read the paper, I don't need to look who is the author, and I can say from which country he or she is. But I'm not saying it's bad, but Asian English is different than European English,
yeah.
And it's very much different from British or US English. So, what is the best way if your supervisor, if you are a PhD student, is good in English, preferably has got a degree from traditional British university where professors were still English? Because if you've got Turkish and Romanian professor, you might learn some good research, but not the language too much. And so you have to look here. What is, when we are talking about language, you know, Elsevier is offering very happily the language support, but for money. And unfortunately, this language support is good from point of linguistics, but not from the point of good professional language related, say, to chemical engineering. I know it because when I'm publishing books, they've got language editors, and I've got always a lot of arguments because those linguists would like to correct some technical terms which are used by engineers worldwide and are probably not exactly correct from the point of linguistic, but everybody's using it. So it's never-ending problem, and we have to deal with this. Now, what are the steps? Subject. Subject is usually given by your topic, PhD topic, and in many cases by projects. As you probably heard at the beginning, by statistics, I used to be the coordinator for more than 90 EU, NATO, UK fund, and other projects. And I am saying, if somebody gives me enough money to build new Concorde plane, I would take it. Because if you've got money and some experience, you can always get the right people and deliver. But if you are PhD, you haven't got too much choice. You are usually funded from something, and this is the subject which is given by some authority or industry, and you have to follow. But mostly the subject is quite wide, so you need to narrow it. And after provide focus for narrowing material. You heard a lot about it in the morning, how to search and how to get it lower. Nowadays, with all those databases, it's not a problem to get 10,000 references or information. But the problem is to get 50, which are coming right to the focus. And this is kind of the art. When you've got references, you should make the notes, categorize the notes, and now it's the point of the decision. You've got information, but you should decide what approach you will use. Typically, as an example, if you use mathematical programming, if you use different optimization, if you use different representation, and so on. You need to make outline, general, after more specific, and after writing outline, you have to fill it in. And this is an issue where the researcher should be a little bit a poet. I've seen many, many papers which are something like a technical report. I measured this, and I've got these results, and this result is good, or this result is not very good. And it's not readable. And such a paper, if it passes through, will not be too successful. It has to be a little bit of poesy, you know, to say why I did it, why I use this approach, what are pros and cons, what are possible pitfalls. And some people are good in it, some are not, but good team. Usually I went as a young engineer through that time, IBM, very powerful company, training, when we got the first big mainframes, and they got the strategy that good research group should be like a hospital surgery team. You know, it has got to get leader, it has got somebody who is making the finances, somebody who is doing the surgery, somebody who is supporting, but somebody who is also writing reports. And the person, the so-called poet, and the person who is writing the report doesn't need to be top researcher. But if you've got this person in the team, it's much better. And of course, you need to get also the person who is called devil advocate. Do you know what it means? This is the person who hesitates. They're saying, and why are you using it? And it might not work. It's, you know, usually this member of the team is not very liked. But it's much better if those questions are made by the member of team. But not by reviewers or examiners, because it's too late. And when you make the copy, this is what I like, leave it for a day or two. As if we are looking on our own paper continuously, we can't see the problem. So leave it, you know, do something else, go for a Sunday trip and return. Another good thing is to ask your colleague, but usually not a very close colleague who is not specialist in the subject, to read it and make the questions. Because good paper is the paper which is not readable only for a very narrow group of specialists, but generally for engineers from your topic. And, edit your work, go through it several times, add-delete the material to achieve the balance. Usually there are two types of authors. One author is, you know, writing, as I say, telegraphically, very, very sparse wording, and the paper is too short, or in most cases the paper is coming, you know, 50 pages, and it's too much. It has to be condensed. Now the question is, how long should be the paper, good paper? Each journal has got in the guide for authors some numbers. You know, Cleaner Production has got 8,000 words. There are the journals Energy, where I am also associated, that has got 5,000. There are journals which got 3,000. If you are writing the paper to Nature, it's 2,500. And authors are asking how crucial is it. Nowadays, it's not so crucial. Why? Because journals are mostly online, electronic. When it was printed, journals were very careful, because the longer paper, if they printed 5,000 copies, if you made one extra page, it meant extra 5,000 pages, and it cost money. So usually you can go a little bit above, you know, if it's 8,000 for Cleaner Production, if you've got 10,000, we will not reject it. On the other side, if it's below 5,000, it doesn't look like original research paper, it's more a short note. Habit is read your paper aloud for yourself. It seems like stupid thing, but it helps. Because if you hear, if it's written, you need to somehow assess if it's worth to listen, if the story is okay. If it's, as I said, this technical report, this is the problem. Now, each journal has got guide for authors, and I, as an editor, have to reject many papers because authors didn't bother to read the rules. It's interesting when I'm asking why you did it, oh, I don't know. And on the website, each journal got guide for authors. So, please read it. But one advice, unfortunately, many journals haven't got this guide for authors updated frequently. It's not always fault of editors, Elsevier. Even when Elsevier is earning a lot of money, they've got chronical shortage of staff, because Elsevier is money-making exercise. And so the best advice is look on 3-4 recently published papers from good authors and follow the same rules. It's the same with references, with the bibliography. As you can see in those metrics, databases, they are, of course, using computers to get it automatically. And when your references are not following the rules, what is happening? You know, the software can't catch them, and in that case, you might have a problem. It's not recognized or it's returned. Now, where to get the advice? Well, it's easy if you've got an experienced colleague. And how you find experienced colleague? Somebody who published a lot, has got a lot of citations. Generally, the person who has got H-index above 20 should be experienced, but the experience should be with the right field and the right journal, because each journal has got slightly different style and slightly different requirements. And obviously, editors and reviewers are those most valuable to get the right information. For example, UPM has got a number of associated editors, and you can find it on the journal website. And those are people whom you should ask when you've got a paper to show it and say, do you think it's okay or what I should do it? I'm sure they would be willing to help you, but if there are 30 of you coming to the poor associated editor, it might take some time because everybody is human. But the most valuable is personal experience, trial. And again, if your supervisor, PhD supervisor, is experienced, it's fine. You've got much less problem, but usually you would have much more problem with your supervisor. As I remember to my PhD's first paper, I returned 10 times, 16 times with comments before we were happy. But after this many cycles inside the group, it went very smoothly. So that's it. The problematic is if your supervisor is fresh and you are the first PhD student, it can be a problem because you both are learning. Now, type of papers, there are generally, each journal has got number of papers. The type of papers, letters to the editor, short notes and others, but what really matters are those two, original research paper and review papers. This matters. I am a little bit surprised why some people are still sending me short notes, because short notes and letter to editors doesn't count. And okay, we have to process them. But if you've got something to say, those are two type of papers that should be used. And now I'm using experience from Journal of Cleaner Production. This is what tells you the length. I already commented on it. We've got review papers, and the review papers are again having pros and cons. What is pro? Review papers attract more citations generally because they cover wider scope and people are more likely cited them. But to make a good review paper is not easy. And many people think that a review paper is to find the references and just cut and paste it, and that it is, but it is not. It requires deep insight, comments, and something which is based on experience. So it's good if review papers are doing students, but they need experienced supervisor who helped them in this. And as you can see, we've got about 12,000. Now, what is the right journal for you? Most people would say a right journal is journal with high impact factor. And it's supported by some measures. I know China. If you are a Chinese student and published paper with impact factor 1, you've got 1,000 RMB. If it's 9, you've got 9,000 RMB. So they are really desperate to get those high impact factor papers. But the higher impact factor, the more difficult to get it through. Journal of Cleaner Production has got rejection rate 70-80%. So it means from 100 submissions, only 20-30 are finally published. And we are not a very high impact factor journal, which is given by the issue that the number of papers is growing. An impact factor is number of references divided by number of published papers. So if we stay with, say, 9,000 papers, our impact factor wouldn't be something close to 6, but would be 10. But if the number of entries is increasing, it's divided by, But on the other hand, it's good because the pool is getting bigger. Now, you've got different publishers. I listed here some of them. Generally, Elsevier is the king. Elsevier is the biggest, and I've been very much surprised when I realized that Elsevier is the biggest company in Europe. Not Rolls-Royce, not BP, but Elsevier, by turnover and by making money, is the biggest company. So it's a huge business. There are some other. Springer did a very clever move, starting to publish Nature. And Nature has got huge impact factor, but by my humble experience, it's not an archive journal. It's a glossy magazine. They are not interested in the really original research. They are interested, I can say it because I'm a regular and I'm author, they are interested in some comments, trends, you know, not really original research. But they started a business and it goes well because it reached high impact factor. And can you imagine those students, because it has got 27, something like this, and 27,000 yuans is already something. So this is the strength of Springer, Taylor, Francis, Wiley, there are some others. Scopus, I'm sure you know everybody. But Scopus, beside authors, has got also search potential. But what I would like to recommend, if you are searching, search not only keywords, but also authors. It helped me quite a lot if you know a number of very important authors who are working in the field, also to search for the names, you know, who published what. Because sometimes keywords doesn't fit very well, but the names do. And Elsevier has got the Science Direct. It is quite good tool. The problem is, like with Scopus, you need to get subscription. Most of good universities around the world got the subscription. This is how Elsevier is making money. But Elsevier now is making huge move to open access. What is open access? Open access is it's available to everybody, which is a great idea. What is not so great, they are charging money. And if you look here, typically they are asking something like $3,000 or euros. But I don't know how your university would be happy if you come to the person responsible for money, to registrar, and say, oh, give me $3,000 for this paper, and $3,000 for that, and $3,000 for that one. There are also some bogus publishers, not serious publishers, because it's a great business. If we decide together to make the publishing company, we would say, okay, we started a journal, we need to get to Scopus, which is a little bit of a problem, but if we are experienced, we can get. And we are happy to publish to open access. A small administrative charge, 200 euros. 200 euros is more approachable, many people would do it. And if we persuade just annually 1,000 people, we've got 200,000 euros. Not bad. And many, many people are doing it, but unfortunately doing it not running a serious job, you know, bogus. And you can find it. You've got every week somebody offering you fast publication, decision made within 2 weeks, and so on. And those journals are caught by publishers, by serious publishers, and put my Web of Science on so-called blacklist. So they are not considered. So be careful if somebody is asking something too easy, because usually too easy, it's not, it's too good to be right. The right journal, besides impact factor, should be also reputation. It means that the journal is considered as really archived and is very good. Different countries have got also a list of preferred journals. I know it from China, I know it from Malaysia. It's the journals which are considered more. But unfortunately, those lists are usually outdated. Authorities are not changing it every year, sometimes every 10 years, and the situation is changing. But if the journal is doing well in Scopus and in Web of Science and Publons, it should be okay. Now, how it's measured journal's impact? this is metrics used by Elsevier, which is different from Web of Science and Publons. And they would like to replace impact factor. And they are trying to do it for some time. I show you some examples. Site score. You know, impact factor has got a problem. Impact factor is just number of citations for last 2 years. 2 years. They've got also 5 years impact factor, but nobody is bothering about it. And 2 years is too short, because good paper shouldn't be forgotten. Be like comet, you know, to appear, be highly cited and die after 2 years. This is not good paper. But for impact factor, it is. So Elsevier has got this site score where they extended it for 3 years, at least something. So it should be better. But now, source of normalized impact per paper, it has got a very good idea, because citation is not the same from every source. You can get citation from very reputable journal with high impact factor, and you can get citation from university journal, which is circulated inside university, but managed to get to Scopus. They are reflecting this one. So again, it would be better. This is another, based on citation data of more than 20,000 peer-reviewed journals indexed by Scopus from 1996. So this one is avoiding those not serious, bogus publishers. Again, it's not bad, but so far they haven't got full recognition. Thomson Reuters was doing not very well, but with Clarivate Analytics, I am afraid that those Elsevier metrics will not go through. And now we are coming to this famous or infamous H index. It's the metrics for evaluating individual scientists. It was actually introduced by the physicist called Hirsch, and he just wrote one short paper, and the first 2-3 years nobody bothered about it. But after, Thomson Reuters smelled and started to promote it, and Mr. Hirsch, who didn't actually make any breaking research, become immortal. Everybody, well, it's not called Hirsch Index anymore, it's called H Index, but it's very much used. And here you've got how it works. As I said, the number of citations is equal to number of your publications in the order from the highest to the lowest. So 10 is that you've got 10 publications with the number of citations minimum 10. If you've got 50, you need to have 50 publications with minimum 550 citations. Besides this is also, you can see it on Google Scholar, H10 index. H10 index is the number of publications which attracted minimum 10 citations, which is telling you something as well, which is not so bad. And on the website, you can get it on Scopus, you can get it on Web of Science, you've got this, and it shows you what is the curve of your publications. And if the curve is here not going down too much, it's okay, because you've got a chance that H index will be increased. If it goes here steeply down, it's a problem. You might need to wait a couple of years before H index will become higher. So this is the definition. Impact factor, measure of frequency, is the average article in the journal being cited in given period of the time. As I said, it's two years. You can get it for journals from this website. The problem is this website is also paid, but as I said, most universities got subscription. And this can serve you when you are looking for a right journal to publish your work. One of the problems is that impact factor is known only to the back. Still, the impact factor for year 2018 will be released traditionally 22nd June 2019. You know, it takes nearly half a year, which is too long. I hope now Clarivate Analytics will do something, because it was traditionally when it was counted by hand. It took nearly 6 months. Nowadays, when you've got everything run by software, you can do it within 2 days, and it can be on 10th of January. So you don't know what will be impact factor. Well, if you are editor, Elsevier is providing us with some guesses each month where we stand, but as an author, you don't know. Another issue is, if you look here, impact factor for 2018 is for papers published in 2016 and 17. So it's 1 year down. And it means that papers published in 2018 and attracting immediately citations in 2018 are not considered, which is not fair. There are many issues like this, but that's it, and we have to deal with it. And this is what I meant. Impact cannot be calculated until all the publications from 2017 has been processed by the indexing agency. Now, what are examples of impact factors? We've got, because I am working in energy and in environment, engineering, I pick up a couple of journals, and a very high impact factor has got a journal called Applied Energy. This is a little bit funny journal, because they've been doing something not very ethical. When you've got the first review, at the end of the review was something formulating like, to increase the impact of your paper, we consider you those papers to be cited. And they were the right papers to be cited. And advice for you, if you would like to be liked by journals and publishers, you should use recent references. Because references which are more than 2 years old not counting for anything. Of course, if they are relevant, we should use them. But I can bet quite a lot of money if you submit to the paper where the most recent reference is from year 2005, it's not going to be too much successful. But it's not only because of those funny issues. I am usually answering the authors who submit this paper. Would you like to use the mobile phone from year 2005 or computer from that time? And you are telling that you've got original novel discoveries and you are comparing it with papers so recent as more than 10 years old. So advice is please use recent references. Now, it's also some police on this catching self-referencing. What is the self-referencing? Self-referencing is if I, as an author, put the number of references which are mine. This is considered ethically incorrect. Mm-hmm. And we used to have, I remember, many years ago in old Ceausescu's Romania, there was one Romanian professor who came on our conference and published something with references Badea, 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 Badea son, Badea wife, and that it was. And he was not very happy when we rejected it always. But self-referencing are also referencing to the same journal. And journals like self-referencing, but to certain level. Because if the journal has got on total more than 50% self-referencing, can be kicked out from Web of Science. And it happened, and it happens every year. So each editor is watching it, and if you think you would please the editor, when you submit something to Journal of Cleaner Production and make 80% of references to Journal of Cleaner Production, you wouldn't be priced very highly. So you should be reasonable with everything. And there are some other metrics, again by Elsevier. I am not going through it in detail because I still got 20 minutes and I would like to tell you some more, but I leave the lecture here if you would like to read it. This is another attempt to replace impact factor by eigenfactor and article influence. There are many attempts, but when you've got a standard, it's quite difficult to change it. What is used is so-called quartiles, metrics which is categorizing the journals to quarter 1, 2, 3, and 4. And this is an example of several journals which you've got here. You can find it on the website. And when the journal is green, it's the right journal for you. If the journal is red, it's on the very beginning, it's in the lowest 25%, and it's a very difficult period for the journal how to attract good authors. When you are green, it's already not a big problem. And this is an example for Cleaner Production, all the rankings, and you can compare it with others. It's again our tables on the website that it can tell you what is good and what is the less good journal. Here is the description. You can also get developments of journals if the journals are going up, flourishing, or not so much. So, advice for authors. Use enough references to show that you know the most recent state of the art. And now it's 2017 and 2018. Don't use self-references mainly, and self-references means to myself as a person and to the same journal that I'm publishing. But very important is and this you should listen carefully, judge who can be a potential, and you can also suggest some reviewers, and it's very good to include some of that person's works, because we are all human, and if you've got a review of a paper and the author is making reference to your work, you are usually more happy than if the author is just ignoring your research. So this makes some sense. Sometimes it's difficult, but in most cases, if you are home in your field, you can judge who would be the reviewer. And as I said, make references correct formally. Learn the new Scopus and the Web of Science. Well, other tools. This is the part of which every student, not only PhD or MSc, should get at least 1-2 hours information. What are those tools? How to work this? What to learn from them? Again, this is what taught me my late supervisor. He said, even the not very good paper, if it's very nicely and neatly presented, has got much better chance to pass through compared with excellent genius research